So, good evening, students. We are beginning with the first topic of fisheries, that is freshwater fish culture. So, now tell me, what is fisheries? Fisheries is the study of freshwater, marine water, estuarine bodies, and aquatic fishes. So, in 11th and 12th standard, we have only freshwater fish culture, right? So, we shall begin with the class. So, the contents of today's lecture is the introduction to fishery sciences, the fisheries activity, what is the aquaculture, classification of fish culture, and freshwater fisheries of India. So, let's start. Introduction. Fishes are the cold-blooded aquatic vertebrates. So, now what is cold-blooded? Cold-blooded are the animals that cannot regulate their internal body temperature according to the changing environment, right? So, they cannot change their temperature. What are the cold-blooded animals? They are the reptiles, birds, fishes. They are also known as poikilothermic animals. Okay, and what are warm-blooded animals? They are the animals that can regulate and maintain a constant internal temperature of the body. And they can survive in any temperature range as they adapt to the harsh conditions. And who are the warm-blooded animals? They are the mammals and the birds. And they are also known as homothermic animals. I hope you have understood the difference between cold-blooded aquatic vertebrates and the warm-blooded animals. Now, what are vertebrates? Vertebrates have backbone, right? They are fishes. Invertebrates, they do not have backbone. The examples of invertebrates are the jellyfishes, lobsters, crabs, insects. They do not have a backbone, hence they are termed as invertebrates. You may be studying this in chapter number 1, the classification as well as the animal kingdom. In your NCERT it's given. So you can refer to page number 56 of the NCERT of biology textbook. There you can find the vertebrata, the divisions, that is Agnatha, Nathostomata, right? So after the completion of class, I would request you to please go on page number 56 of your biology textbook of standard 11th. Now they respire with gills. As we all know, what is the respiratory system in the fishes? They respire with gills. They swim with the help of fins. So fishes, they have fins through which they can swim in the water. There are 21,585 existing species of fishes, out of which 41.2% inhabit fresh water. So you can see that almost 41.2% they inhabit the fresh water, remaining they go in the brackish water and the marine water. Economically important animals, as you can see that fishes, with the help of fishes, the farmers, the fishermen, they rear the fishes, they hatch the fishes, and after that they sell it. So it is of most economically important. They are good source of high quality proteins, that is they contain lysine and sulfur contain amino acids. So amino acid, it forms the proteins, right? So lysine and sulfur are present in the fishes. It has high polyunsaturated fatty acid, especially omega-3. You might have heard of omega-3 fatty acid, which is responsible in lowering blood cholesterol levels. So it is also referred to as PUFA, P-U-F-A, polyunsaturated fatty acids. And it is also said that we should include polyunsaturated fatty acids in a diet in order to avoid the cardiovascular disease. Now, what are the cardiovascular disease? It is related with your heart, your arteries, and the veins of the body. See, if you have the unsaturated fatty acids, saturated fatty acid, then it gets accumulated in your arteries and you can suffer from arteriosclerosis or the atherosclerosis, which is really difficult, and it results in heart attack, cardiac failures. So that is the reason polyunsaturated fatty acids, PUFA, is very important. And where we get this PUFA, we get it from the fishes, that is omega-3 fatty acids. There are also non-fish aquatic animals. They are prawns, shrimps, cattlefish, oyster, and etc. They are also important, right? Now, fisheries activity. The fishery activities is broadly classified into two. that is fin fisheries and non-fin fisheries. What are fin fisheries? They are the true fishes which have fins. And what are non-fin fisheries? They are other than the true fishes. They don't have fins. They are the prawns, crabs, lobsters, oysters, sea cucumber, frog and seaweeds. So they are non-fin fisheries. So you may also note this. It is broadly classified into fin fisheries and non-fin fisheries. So here you can see there is a diagram of fish. This is Labio rohita, which is also known as Rohu in our normal language. And in scientific language, it is known as Labio rohita. So the first one is a true fish, that is a fin fisheries. And the second photo which you can see is of the seaweed. Seaweed, and the third is the prawns. So they are non-fin fisheries, okay, that are, they don't have fins, and therefore they are included in non-fin fisheries. Now, fin and non-fin fisheries are further divided into capture fisheries and culture fisheries. Capture fisheries are the exploitation of aquatic organisms without stocking seeds. So in this capture fisheries, you don't stock the seeds. Now, what is stocking the seeds? You need not put the seeds into the water. You just capture those fishes. In culture fisheries, scientific method of fish cultivation is obtained with maximum care. The seeds are stocked, nursed and reared. So you need to stock the seeds. You need to take care of them. You need to proper rear them in culture fisheries. Capture fisheries is practiced in all types of water bodies, whether it be ponds, lakes, anything. So capture fisheries is practiced in all type of water bodies, and culture fisheries is practiced only in specific ponds. They are constructed and fertilized. Why they are fertilized? Because we need to nurse those fishes. We need to rear them. So that is the reason fertilization of ponds is very important in culture fisheries. In capture fisheries, production of fishes from natural sources is decreasing. Why it is decreasing? You may be knowing that the small fishes are eaten up by large fishes, and large fishes are further eaten by more large fishes. That is the reason the yield obtained is very less in the capture fisheries. There is no specific yield. But in culture fisheries, we obtain a specific yield. And culture fisheries also includes culture of various organisms, such as prawns, crabs, as I already told you, that is non-fin fisheries. And this is known as the aquaculture. Now, what is aquaculture? It is scientific rearing of aquatic organisms under controlled condition. Aquatic organisms can be any, like true fishes or non-true fishes, that is fin fishes and non-fin fishes. So aquaculture is not specific to only fishes, and it is not confined only to fishes, but it is including the lobsters, crabs, that is the non-fin fishes also. The important word here is the controlled condition. We need to have a specific pH, specific temperature in order to rear these fishes or rear these organisms. It is a mean to increase jobs, enhance sport and commercial fishes. As we have already discussed, fishes are of economical importance. Many areas, as you know, Goa, they have the main yield of jobs is the fisheries. Right? So they just capture the fisheries, they culture the fishes, and then they sell it. So it is a mean of economical importance in many places where you have large lakes or water bodies. So main occupation there for the people is the fishes. It is a reliable source of protein-rich foods for future. We have already discussed it contains omega-3 fatty acid, which is very important. As it lowers the blood cholesterol and it helps in preventing cardiovascular diseases. Now we move on to the classification of fish culture. Fish culture is classified on the basis of fish culture, that is where the fishes are cultured, right? So there are three freshwater fish culture. What is a freshwater? The salinity, the salt content of the freshwater is less than 0.05%. That is the reason it is known as freshwater. The examples of the freshwater are streams, rivers, lakes, ponds, right? So wherever you find less than 0.05% of salt, it is considered as a freshwater. What is a brackish water? Brackish water is a water where the salt content is less than 3% but more than 0.05%. It is a mixture of fresh water and the marine water. The examples of the brackish water are estuaries. Now, what is an estuary? It is a point where a river meets sea. So, estuary is a point where a river is meeting the sea, and this is an example of the brackish water. Brackish water is the water in which the salt content is more than 0.05% but less than 3%. Then the last is the marine water fish culture. The salt content of the marine water is more than 3%. It is made of 2/3 of earth surfaces, that is oceans and seas. So most of the earth, that is the 2/3 of the earth, is covered by the marine water, and the examples are the ocean and the seas. Now the second classification is on the basis of temperature of the water. So there are two types of temperature. One is a warm temperature and the other is a cold water. So what is a warm water? Warm water ranges from the temperature 20 to 40 degrees Celsius, and cold water ranges up to 20 degrees Celsius, right? It can be in minus also, it can be in plus also. Classification of fish culture. On the basis of species stocked, right? There are three types of stocking of fishes are done. The first is the monoculture, second is polyculture or the composite culture, and third is the integrated farming. Monoculture, the word itself describes, mono means single. So the single species of fishes are cultured in the monoculture. Polyculture or the composite culture, in this more than one species of fishes are cultured. And then integrated farming. Fishes are cultured along with the other animals. So in integrated farming, there can be one species, more than one species of the fishes, which are cultured with other organisms, other animals of the aquatic body, that is the prawns, lobsters, seaweeds, right? Integrated farming consists of fishes which are cultured along with the other animals. On the basis of level of management, it is further classified into four: traditional, extensive, semi-intensive, and finally intensive. Children, you need to learn all these things, okay? This I have shown in the tabular form in order to make it easier for you so that you can remember it. Please write it same which I have shown in the PPT in your answer sheet. You will be getting full marks. It will be easy for the examiner to check and give you marks. So on the basis of level of management, it is divided into four: traditional, extensive, semi-intensive and intensive. Now we'll discuss about the traditional. Traditional is the simplest and very old method. There is no species selection. Okay, it's not, there is no species selection is there in traditional method. You can go for Labio rohita, you can go for Sirenis megala. There is no species selection. And the yield obtained is also very less because it is traditional, very old, simplest method. So yield obtained is also very less. Now we come to the extensive. Extensive is the improved. It is comparative to the traditional one, right? It is improved system. In this, species are cultured on the natural foods. So the fishes are cultured on the natural foods in the extensive culture. In the semi-intensive culture, it is more improved than the extensive and the traditional one. The species are selected. As I told you that if I want to go for only rohu fish, that is Labio rohita, so I'm going to select it and then rear it. And according to that only, I'll be selecting the water, the pH, the temperature of the water, and the aquatic conditions will be selected on the basis of the fishes, fish species that I will select. In this, the artificial food is given to the fishes. Artificial food is given in order because there are many times that the fishes may not get the natural food in the water. So that is the reason artificial food is given in order to improve the yield of the fishes. And finally, the intensive one. Intensive is highly evolved. The latest which we use in the level of management is the intensive. High stocking density, we stock more and more seeds, we stock more and more fishes. And here the formulated artificial food is given. What is mean by formulated artificial food? In this, we add specific nutrients, specific amino acids, specific proteins for the fishes to grow. and hence the formulated artificial food is given. And when it is given, we get more and more improved yield. Freshwater Fishery Resources of India. Now, freshwater fishery resources of India are highly diversified in nature. They vary from altitude, altitude is the height, subtemperate rivers, lakes, reservoirs, and ponds to subtropical water bodies. So it may range from hot water bodies to cold water bodies. Inland fisheries resources of India are supported by five major river systems. The length of the rivers is 1.7 lakh kilometers. So length of the river in India is 1.7 lakh kilometers. It includes all the rivers of India. On these rivers, reservoirs and dams are constructed. So children, this is the table which is given in your book. You can refer to Pradnya's Freshwater Fish Culture, Standard 11. In this, on page number 4, this particular table is given. You can refer to this table. It is not that important that you should remember it, but for your knowledge, you can just take this. You need to know what are the resources, that is rivers, canals and streams, reservoirs and lakes, ponds and tanks, beels and oxbow lakes. Now, what is an oxbow lake? Oxbow lakes are the U-shaped lakes that forms when a wide river is cut off, creating a freestanding body of water. So that is an oxbow lake. Okay. Flood plains and derelict water. What is derelict water? Derelict is generally clogged or wet water bodies. And the brackish water, as I already told you, the salt content of the brackish water is less than 3%, but more than 0.05%. So you can just refer to this, that rivers have total area 29,000 kilometers, canals and stream 1,42,000 kilometers, reservoirs and lake 2.05 milli hectares, ponds and tanks, beels and oxbow lakes 2.85 milli hectares, 15373 hectares, okay, flood plains and derelict water 236.911 hectares, and brackish water 2.7 milli hectares. So you can refer to this. The present exploitation, what do you mean by exploitation? It means how much fishes or how much potential is there, how much we are actually extracting from the water bodies, how many fishes are we extracting, or how many aquatic organisms are we extracting from that particular water body. So as you can see, present exploitation, at present we are exploiting 1000 kilograms per kilometer per year, okay, from the rivers. 10 to 15 kg from the canals, 200 to 225 kg from reservoirs and lake, 20 to 25 kilograms from ponds and tanks, 50 to 100 kg from beels, oxbow lakes, 30 kg from flood and plains, brackish water 60 kg. So tell me, what is the maximum amount of exploitation which is there and in which resource? You can answer in the chat box. So the answer is 100 kg, 200 to 225 kg, right? 200 to 225 kg is the highest that is obtained from the reservoirs and lakes. The next is 100 kg, which is obtained from the rivers. Okay, please remember this. The highest exploitation is from the reservoirs and lakes, and the second highest is from the rivers. This is very important. Present level of technology use, that is traditional cast nets, gill nets. So you are well aware about the nets that we use in the fishery culture. You might have seen. Now, what is the potential? What do you mean by potential? That this can be there, but the exploitation is very, very less than the potential of that particular water body. So the potential of the river is 300 to 500. But what are we actually exploiting? What are we getting? We are getting only 100 kg. In canals and streams, we are the potential is 30 to 50 kilograms, but we are only getting 10 to 15. Reservoirs and lakes, it is 50 to 100 grams is the potential, but we are only getting 200 to 225. And please keep the values and their properties also in mind, that traditional cast nets and gill nets are used. Beels and oxbow lakes, they have 100 to 200 capacity potential, and then we are getting 50 to 100 kilograms. Flood 50 to 100, but still we are only exploiting 30 kg. So please keep this in mind. Now we go on to the broad outline of the fishery activities. Before this, children, I would like to tell you what are the inland fisheries, what are the inland water bodies. Inland waters are the permanent water bodies, okay? And it is mostly formed in the coastal zones where properties and use are dominated by the permanent occurrence of the flood conditions, where there is a lot and lot of water bodies. There we have the inland waters such as lakes, rivers, streams. They are permanent, mostly they are permanent. There are some artificial lakes also which we form, that is a different thing. But inland waters are the ones which have the permanent occurrence, that is lakes, rivers, streams. Now we go on to the broad line of fisheries activities. What are fisheries activities? We have three steps. The first step is fish catching. The second step is fish processing. And the third step is fish marketing. So what we are supposed to do first, we need to catch the fish. Then we need to process the fish. And then finally, we have to go for the marketing of fish where it will reach the consumer. So fish catching is at the place of the producer and the fish marketing is at the level of the consumer. Fish catching. What is a fish catching? In fisheries business, the final product is a fish and other aquatic organism, as we all know. Why are we going for this aquaculture? Because we need to obtain something. And what is that something? We need to obtain either fish or other aquatic organisms, as I already told you, lobsters, prawns, crabs, oysters, which have high economical importance. Fishes, they are consumed by human beings as foods. There are many people who have this, non-vegetarian people, they may be having this fishes as their foods. As fishes are aquatic animals, they need to be caught by catching devices such as nets. So, because they are aquatic animals, we need to take them out of the water bodies, and for that we need the catching devices such as nets. Aquaculture is underwater culture, underwater agriculture, okay? So aquaculture is the underwater agriculture, and term harvesting can be applied for catching of fishes. Fish seed, that is spawn. So what is a spawn? It is a fish seed. As we discussed earlier, that we need to stock the fishes. So what we need to stock? We need to stock the spawn. Okay, usually spawn is stocked, and apart from the spawn, fry, fingerling is harvested by using a special type of net called as fry net. Now, what is the difference between spawn, fry, fingerling? Is it the same? No, it is not the same. Fish seed is known as spawn. Okay, and after 7 to 10 days of this spawn has grown up into a fry, the fry is present in the small and the shallow ponds. After the fish grows in 10 to 15 centimeter in size, we refer it to that of fingerling. Why it is called as fingerling? Because we have a finger of 10 to 5 centimeter approximately. That is why we refer it to as a fingerling. And fingerling, they need large size of water body and slightly deeper ponds. Okay, so this is the difference between spawn, fry and fingerling. Please note it. After harvesting, they are kept for conditioning in harbor for 2 to 3 hours so that they may adjust to the small space. Children, harbor, you need to pronounce this as harbor. And harbor are the fixed net enclosure similar to inverted mosquito net. You might have seen the mosquito nets, and if you invert it, it becomes a harbor. And it is made up of polyethylene netting with joints in the nylon thread. So harpa is just nothing but the inverted mosquito net, which is made up of polyethylene netting with joints in the nylon thread. So harpa is very important. And then after the fingerling is harvested, we have to keep it in harpa for 2 to 3 hours so that they may adjust to the small space. It's very important for the fishes to the fingerling to adjust. That is the reason in the big spaces. Therefore, we need to keep them in small space in order to first acclimatize them with it. And then when later on, we can make them to go in the large space. After condition, they are packed in air-filled containers. So what is conditioning? We just release them in the small space. So they get accustomed, they get conditioned to that particular environment. And then we need to pack it in the air-filled containers. Why we need to pack it in an air-filled containers? Because they need oxygen to survive, and hence they can be transported to a longer distance only when we keep them in the air-filled containers. Fish catching. Large size fishes are caught by using different types of nets. So there are various nets. We don't need to go into deep of those nets, but we need to just understand the broad classification, that is active nets, passive nets, and the miscellaneous nets. Hooks and traps are also used for catching of the carnivorous fishes. There are carnivorous fishes, and hence we need to go for hooks and traps, because of which we can catch those carnivorous fishes. In normal, if you go for fishing, so you have a fish rod, and there you just attach any kind of fingerling, or you go for any kind of food for that fish in the hook, so that when the large fish will have that hook, will have that food, they will attach themselves into the hook, so that can come out easily. Hence, hooks and traps are used for catching of the carnivorous fishes. Life of a craft or gear is increased with proper preservation, repair, and the maintenance. So as we know, if we go for preservation, repair, and maintenance, so anything if we go for preservation, it will have a greater life. Therefore, life of a craft or gear is increased by proper preservation, repair, and maintenance. Now we come on to the fish processing. Generally, fish and prawns are sold in the market in fresh condition. Right? Generally, they are sold in the fresh condition. Fishes are perishable product. What is a perishable product? Perishable means they get spoiled. Okay? So this is known as perishable product, which gets spoiled or which gets destroyed or which is not proper to eat. That is known as perishable product. And because of their perishable nature, they start to spoil immediately after catching. So once we catch those fishes from the water, they are out of the water body. So they start spoiling immediately. To save fishes from such condition, preservation and processing is necessary. So we need to save these fishes because they are of highly economical importance. And if we don't save them, so there will be more and more deaths of the fishes, such as perishability of the fishes. It will not be good for consuming, and hence there will be destruction of economic loss. Hence we need to go for preservation and processing. Fishes are transported from production center to the consuming center by using various methods such as bicycle, motor vehicles, trains, etc. So we know from the center of production to the center of consumption, we need to travel, we need to transport these fishes. Before transportation, fishes are handled carefully. They need to be handled carefully. Mud, waste materials are removed by cleaning in fresh water. So children, what happens when you catch the fishes? So they usually are in a natural condition in the water bodies. So when you catch them, there are many things that would be applicable to it. That is, the mud will be there on the water on the body of the fishes. There will be waste materials of the fishes. And hence, we are supposed to remove it by putting it in the fresh water. We also need to go for packing with the ice. They are sent to the market. Okay, once we catch the fishes, we need to process it. How we need to process it? We need to clean the mud, waste materials from the body of the fishes. And after that, we need to pack it with the ice. And then we are supposed to send it to the market. They are preserved and processed by using such method as salting, sun drying, chilling with ice, freezing, and refrigeration. So we'll be talking about this in the next slide. Each method has its own advantages and disadvantages. Chilling. What is the chilling? Chilling is obtained by covering fish with the layers of ice. Okay. So this is chilling. What happens is you put ice below the fish. You put the fish on that ice, and again you cover that fish with the eye of the fish with the ice of the second layer. It is only for a short period. Okay. Because what is ice? Ice, it turns into water. Okay. So it cannot be stored for a longer period. That is the reason. It has to be transported very early. Applicable from landing to the consuming center. Freezing is more effective than chilling. So chilling is not very effective as freezing. Now what is freezing? It is done by using mixture of ice and salt or refrigeration. So we need to add ice and salt, or we need to refrigerate it. It prevents the rancidity. The deep freezing prevents denaturation and retains freshness and flavor of the fish to maximum. So if we don't freeze it or if we don't preserve it, what will happen? It is a perishable product. So the flavor of the fish will get destroyed. Okay. So in order to save the flavor of the fish, retain the freshness of the fishes, we need to go for the processing, that is the freezing. Freeze drying is a modification of the deep freezing. It completely removes all chances of the denaturation. What is a denaturation? Again, it is a spoiling. In this, deep frozen fish at minus 20 degrees Celsius is then dried by direct sublimation. What is a sublimation? If we talk about ice to water, then we go for ice, water, and then water vapor. But in the sublimation, instead of going into the liquid water, we go directly from ice to water vapor. Okay, that is from solid to the gaseous state. We don't go into the liquid state. For this process, fish is exposed to 14 degrees Celsius in a vacuum frozen chamber. Now the next process is canning. Canning is very effective method, but it is very costly. So most of the people in India, most of the fishermen in India, they cannot afford canning. So that is the reason they go for sun drying or they go for freezing. Okay. So canning is a very effective method, but it is costly. Product remains in good condition with maximum flavor. We get maximum flavor in the canning process. And the fish remains in the good condition. Fish is cut into boneless pieces. Okay. It has to be cut into boneless pieces and then pickled to improve taste. The pickle is added to it so that it improves the taste. Preliminary cooking is carried out. Cooled pieces are kept in cans and cans are finally sealed in the canneries. It is just smaller than cans, that is the canneries. Generally, uneconomical small sized fishes are preserved by sun drying. What is the sun drying? Just keeping the fish below the sun is the sun drying. It can be kept on land or then it can be also kept on a mat below the sun, and hence it is known as sun drying. And why we go for sun drying? Because we know that the fish is not of more economical importance, and so going for costly process like canning or refrigeration will be just waste of money. That is the reason we go for sun drying, which is very cheap. That is, you need not pay for the amount of sunlight you use. Fishes after catching are washed by rinsing in brine water and then spread on the mat and left to dry until the complete water evaporates. Okay, so fishes are catched. After catching are washed, okay, by rinsing in the brine water and then spread on the mat, as I already told you, and left to dry until the complete water evaporates. So children, today we will be completing till fish processing only. We have two topics left, that is fish marketing and the role of freshwater fishery in the rural development. So we'll be doing it in the next class. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. I'll be sharing either the PPT or my handwritten notes to you, so it will be easy. And one thing I would like to tell you is, in fisheries, you need to go for point-wise writing, because there are marks on points. If the question is of 10 marks, then compulsory you need to go for 20 points. Half marks on each point is awarded to the student. Right? If you have any questions, any doubts, you can ask me. I'll be providing you with the PPTs and the handwritten notes, so it will be easy for you. And one more thing, I have already uploaded the paper pattern of fisheries. Please go through the paper pattern of fisheries. The video is there. You can search it in DCM Junior College, paper pattern of fisheries. You will be getting it there. Asavari, preliminary cooking is the advanced preparation, okay, which you need to do. As I already told you, that pickling, okay, when you add the pickle to this fishes, okay, so it gets as a preliminary cooking. This is known as preliminary cooking. Bit of polyculture and integrated farming, as I already told you, in polyculture, you have more than two types of species are reared or cultured in polyculture, of fishes only. But in integrated farming, you have fishes also, you have other organisms from aquaculture, that is, as I told you, lobsters, prawns, crabs. Okay, so integrated farming consists of fishes as well as the aquatic organisms. And in polyculture, we only have the fishes, that is more than two types of fishes in polyculture. I hope, Aradhya, your doubt is solved. Children, is there any other doubt, or then we can end our class? Last slide, which last slide? This fish processing? Asavari? Children, if you have any other doubts, you can just message through WhatsApp also, okay? And please see to it that you really go through the paper pattern which I have uploaded in the previous video. That is very important. Asavari, brine water is a water which has high concentration solution of salt. Okay, so it is a salty water, that is NaCl, and that is the reason it helps in preventing the spoilage of fishes. Hence we have to go for rinsing it in the brine water. So whatever the mud is there, whatever the problem is there with the fishes on its body, so it gets solved there. We need to clean it with the brine water. Any other doubt, children? I hope you have understood today's class. We'll just go for a revision, a quick revision of what we have studied today, okay? Still, if you have doubts, you can ask me. So we have studied fisheries in the contents, that is introduction, fisheries activity, aquaculture, classification of fish culture, freshwater fisheries of India. The first thing we have studied is the introduction, that is cold-blooded aquatic vertebrates, respire with gills, swims with the help of fins. This is very common. Please go through this. Important is they have amino acids, that is the lysine and sulfur, and they have omega-3 fatty acid, which helps in the lowering of blood cholesterol level, prevents cardiovascular diseases. This is very important. Then fisheries activity, fin fisheries, non-fin fisheries. What are fin fisheries? They are the true fishes. What are the non-fin fisheries? They are the other than true fishes, prawns, crabs, lobsters. This is the first diagram is of Rohu, second is seaweed, the third is the prawn. Fin and non-fin fisheries, it is further divided into capture fisheries, culture fisheries. Capture fisheries, we don't stock the seeds, but we only capture it. In culture fisheries, we stock the seeds, we nurse and we rear them. Aquaculture is the scientific rearing of aquatic organisms under controlled condition. As I told you, then we need to maintain the pH. We need to maintain the temperature of the body, because if the pH and temperature of the water body is disturbed, then there are high chances of the fishes or the aquatic organisms to die. Classification of fish culture is there on the basis on the fish culture, fresh water, brackish water, marine water. Then temperature of water, warm water, cold water. Warm water is 20 to 40 degrees Celsius. Cold water is up to 20 degrees Celsius. Right? Then on the basis of species stocked, monoculture, polyculture, integrated farming. Monoculture, only single species of fishes. Polyculture, more than one species of fishes. This is important. Of fishes is important. Integrated farming, fishes as well as other animals are cultured in this. On the level of management, traditional, extensive, semi-intensive and intensive. Freshwater fishery resources, that is lakes, reservoirs, rivers, streams, ponds, other freshwater fishery resources, inland waters as I discussed. Then freshwater fishery resources, please just go through this table. You need not learn this table completely, but you need to know the resources. Then broad outline of fisheries activity, in which we have covered fish catching and fish processing today. We'll be covering fish marketing and role of freshwater fishery in the rural development tomorrow. Also, we'll be beginning with the next chapter tomorrow. Then we have seen what is fish catching. Please remember what is the difference between spawn, fry and fingerling, and why it is known as fingerling. Please see to it. You need to know what is hapa. Okay, fish catching, there, how many types of nets are there, active, passive nets and the miscellaneous nets, how you catch the carnivorous fishes, that is also important. Fish processing, again we come to fish processing, how we need to process it before marketing. So this is important, please go through this. Salting, sun drying, chilling with ice, freezing and refrigeration. Fish process, again I told you about these. Chilling, freezing, freeze drying, please go through this. Canning. And please remember this, that when the fishes are uneconomical, or the small sized fishes which are not sold with a high amount of value in the market, so you need to go for sun drying. This is important, because you need to go for economical importance. It's very important. Okay, what is the doubt? What canning exactly means? But a canning is a method of food preservation, okay? In which it is packed in airtight container. It is known as canning. You may also be getting many drinks, right? So it is also canned. Canned water bottles are there, or canned drinks are there. Okay, so fishes also need to be canned in proper airtight containers so that it is not spoiled. Because once it gets the temperature, humidity from outside, it gets spoiled, as it is a perishable product. I hope, Vaibhavi, you understood. So canning is, you need to preserve in cans as you get it in canned water bottles or the cold drinks. In the same way, you are supposed to go for canning of fishes. Children, is there any other doubt? And one more thing, I request you to please go on to page number 56 of your NCERT of biology textbook, where you will be finding the divisions of vertebrata, Ignatha, Anathostomata, then the superclass, Pisces, Tetrapoda. This is also very important, you should know this. Beta, I told you, Vaibhavi, brackish water is the water body in which the salt concentration is less than 3% but greater than 0.05%. If you have salt concentration less than 0.05%, then it is the fresh water. And if you have the salt concentration between 0.05 to 3%, it is a brackish water. And if you are having a salt concentration more than 3%, then it is a marine water. Asavari, canneries are the places where the cans are sealed or the food is canned. So it is a place where the food is canned, that is known as canneries. So the cans are finally sealed in the canneries. In the canneries only you are going to seal the cans. That is the reason it is written cans are finally sealed in the canneries. In fisheries, children, you are supposed to just go for writing and writing. Okay, it's not about if you are having some problems, right? You can just WhatsApp. And in fisheries, what you are supposed to do is you need to make points. More the points, more the marks. It obviously it won't be more than the maximum marks. But if you go for suppose 50 marks is there, then you are supposed to go for 100 points. This is just an example. If you have 10 marks, then 20 points. Mostly you get a full question in this fish processing. Please see to it that you do it properly. Okay, children. So I think so we are done with the time also. If you still have any problems, again, I repeat, you can ask me through WhatsApp. You can just post your doubts. Please read page number 1, page number 2 and page number 3 of your fisheries textbook. You can refer to Pragna's Freshwater Fish Culture. Right? So I hope you have understood. Thank you. Asavari, you have to write in points. Beta, you can write either in numbering form or the bullet form. That won't matter. But it would be much better if you go for a numbering form. Okay, because it will be easy for the examiner. So I would suggest you to go for numbering form.